Chang from Taichung, Taipei, and he's another good friend of ours, and he will tell you some quality such of an approach in Taiwan.
Okay, good morning. The thanks for the organization and the committee for invitation, particularly Professor Kevin Chen. I'm happy to be the last speaker for this session on the quality control of the herbs. Because of my previous experience, I had more than 10 years working in the university hospital for the Chinese Crew Drug Pharmacy. We work closely with the TCM practitioner. We dispense the prescriptions, the drug. So because of this 10 years experience with the TCM practitioner, I pay more attention to the major issues in the TCM communities. As you understand, the TCM, traditional Chinese medicine, has been very popular in Taiwan, just like that in China. And in 1995, TCM was also incorporated in our national health insurance. So with the insurance ID, people walk into any hospital, whether you want to refer to a TCM doctor or Western doctors, it's all covered by the insurance. So in my talk, the current regulations and quality control practice of the TCM herb and herbal preparations, particularly together with the some of the work we did in the past, will be addressed. As you understand that the TCM traditionally, we take decoctions. We take the herb and we may have to make decoctions. And nowadays, of course, we have various type of preparations. The major one is the extracted granule. We have the extract granule of a single herb and also extract granule of a compound formula. Of course, other tablet, pills, powder, capsule, etc. are also available. So this is how we dispense all the traditional prescriptions. And as the patient brings those herbs home, they have to make decoctions, and usually it's time consuming. So nowadays, we have the extract granule. And also only this type of dosage form were covered by the National Health Insurance. And we do have this the concentrated granule produced by major pharmaceutical companies in Taiwan. We have the extract granule of a single herb, and we also have extract granule of a compound formula, a formula which may made up of 4, 8, 12, or even up to 16 or 20 herbs together. And as many speakers just mentioned in this session, there are the identification and variation herbs. There are many methods. We have the species identification, morphological, microscopic, chemical, biological, including the most modern DNA identification, as the Professor Chen Shilin's group just mentioned. Of course, the identification of the herb is important in the medicinal plant. As we walk in the field, in the garden, by taking a look of the herbs, we can, based on whether it's a herbaceous or woody plant, and the shape of the leaves, or the flower, the color, etc. And finally, we track down which family, which genus, and which species. However, it's still not easy, even for experts. But however, for the people who work in the crew drugs, we only use part of the plant. So what is it? Without the leaf, without the flower, what is it? That makes things more complicated, right? That actually is the morus alba. And of course, for the major TCM herb species, yes, like ginseng, like Angelica sinensis, we can tell immediately from the smell or the shape. And also, we have the microscopic examinations, just like Professor Zhao just mentioned, he's really an expert in this field. And also, we do the microscopic features of the powders, etc. But however, I'd like to mention, emphasize that MI identification doesn't equals to origin identification. Actually, microscopic identification is just one of the methods. in identification of the herbs. For example, with this, what is it? If you don't know, then why don't you make a microscopic examination? It still didn't give you the answer, right? So actually, the reference standard is essential. Okay, without compilations, the MI just means nothing. And also, we have the chemical identifications. And since I'm the faculty in the university and also the head of the herbal department in the university hospital, so I often encounter or often been asked, people may come to me with a package of yellow powders. Hey, Professor Zhang, can you identify this for me? No, it's impossible. But however, if we just ask single question, Professor Zhang, do this powder contain ginseng, or do this powder contain angelica sinensis? Then just by a simple TOC, a chromatogram, then you can solve the problem. But if you want to have the exact identification, absolute identification, it's really impossible. And of course, we do the SPOC analysis, fingerprint, etc., biological identification, and also the modern DNA identification, as mentioned by Professor Chen Shilin's group. And just like MI, DNA identification is not for routine process. For example, by taking a look, it's ginseng, it's angelica, and what the hell you do DNA and identification, right? So only those traditional method cannot give you the answer. Then we have the last resort or last the options to do that. And what impressed me was 2 or 3 years ago, there's a legal case. Because there's a preparation made by Guilu or Shenjiao, which is made up of four herb species. We have the ginseng, we have the lisim guineensis, the seed, the fruit, and together with the deer horn and the turtle shell. Deer horn is okay, but it's to the turtle shell. Many turtle species, actually, it's currently endangered species, and it's not allowed to be sold or to be exported. But there's a case because they have to make a gelatin cake, and it may take a couple of days. After cooking, and finally come up with a gelatin cake as on the right bottom side there. But however, our FDA was being able to trace back which turtle species this gelatin cake was made from. That really impressed me. Okay, so as you understand, DNA analysis is not for routine, procedures. And of course, in the pharmaceutical company, they do have loss and dry, total ash, as in sort of ash, those chemical specifications. And of course, the standard, we have to follow the pharmacopeia. And like Professor Kevin Chen just mentioned, there are many herbal pharmacopoeia around the world. But of course, in Taiwan, we have our first pharmacopoeia in 2004, which only include 200 species. Definitely, it's not enough. So early last year, we have the second version, which include up to 300 species. And of course, besides that, we also refer to ZP, Japanese pharmacopoeia, and also the PRC's pharmacopoeia as well. This is our first pharmacopoeia, and this is the second version published early last year. Of course, the pharmacopoeia described all the specifications of the herbs, and lemon test, and assay, various assays, etc. But besides that, we also do through the support of the Department of Health, we try to compare, including try to replace some photos, and then finally we have the color illustration of Taiwan Herbal Pharmacopeia, so that we have this color illustration side by side with our Herbal Pharmacopeia, and the Professor He, Dr. He also is the co-author of this book, and then we also provide a CD together with that. So. Even though it's in Chinese, but however, all the Latin name, all the color photo is universal, right? So people can still be able to read it. And besides that, we also have the traditional medicines, particularly to the herbs, the adulteration is very serious issue. So as a training purpose, for training purposes, we help the Department of Health compile a booklet, which about 70 sets of the herbs. Instead of a lengthy, woody descriptions of the shape of the herbs, we just try to provide the color photos. For example, with this species, the tsugu, the correct species, look the one on the top, but if you found your store, your herbal store have the one with the sharp end, definitely you know you have the wrong species. So for easy for the herbal practitioner to be able to identify the genuine one from the adulterated one. And besides that, we also, besides the booklet, we also provide a CD as a training purposes. For example, the Pugonging supposed to be the Taroxacic herba, which is we call dandelion. But however, people may also use Lactuca chinensis instead. So this is dandelion and the Lactuca. Sure, as to do the fresh herb, looks different. But once you dried it up, so close, difficult to identify. Like Wangbu Liu Xing, supposed to be the seed of Bacaria. But however, people do use the menastoma instead. So this is Wangbu Liu Xing, but they use the Yemudan, but not instead of the seed, they use the stem. So sure, that's not right. And also as to the Astragalus huangqi, the actually it's one of the most commonly used TCM herbs. In China, people use Astragalus species, but in Taiwan, it seems people prefer to use Hedysalum species. Of course, these two are, even though belong to Leguminosae family, but definitely it's not the same. And I'd like to lead to your attention was the identification of the herbs is important. Clinically, if you don't use the correct species, definitely you will not be able to lead to the expected clinical efficacy. But as in academic field, we have a case if a few years ago in Taiwan, a phytochemist who tried to work on a poisonous plant, Euphorbia helioscopia, in Chinese we call zheqi. So he went to a herbal store and make sure this is the zheqi. And then after preliminary study, he found the cytotoxic and anti-cancer activity, etc. So he passed this material over to a PhD student. The student worked for almost 5 years and came up with 80, 90 compounds, and even about more than 10 have a novel new compound, and then tried to publish. But however, they submitted the paper to Journal of Nature Product. The first editor, reviewer says, oh, it comes from a famous institute in Taiwan, so just make some grammar corrections, it's okay. And then the second reviewer says, it became to euphorbiaceae, but it doesn't contain the unique 4-pol ester type of compound at all. Instead, it comes up with the cardioglycoside, which never been found in euphorbiaceae family. So returned the manuscript, and then finally they came up with this euphorbiaceae helioscopia. And then it only have a very tiny hairy root. So this is genuine, the helioscopia zheqi. But then later on, when we take many help from China, they finally come up with to be swap kinensis. So we have to thank the reviewer, second reviewer, to identify these mistakes. Otherwise, once it's published, yes, a Fobiaceae plant from a Fobiaceae family have the cardioglycoside type of compound. Okay, so this is important. And of course, because of the aristolochic acid incident, the government banned the use of 5 aristolochic acid containing herbs. And we also have a chance to work on the sulfur dioxide humigations, and we do survey on the commonly herbs used in Taiwan market. And finally, we came up with 500 milligram per kilo, 500 ppm for major TCM herbs as a limit. So actually this in 2004, in our first edition of Taiwan Herbal Pharmacopeia, actually it's the first pharmacopeia to set the limit for sulfur dioxide. Okay, but however in 2008, Korean government set the limit 300 ppm for about 300 species of herbs imported into Korea. Of course, it do have a great pleasure for our FDA people, but even included the SFDA in China. Finally, they come up with a limit of 400 ppm for 10 most frequently fumigated herb species and 100 ppm for the others. And of course, they also set some limit for pesticides and also heavy metal, etc. And one of the issues I'd like to point to your attention was a few years ago, we found out that some of the herbs was adulterated with the so-called weight gaining powder. It doesn't mean by taking this powder, you are gaining your weight, okay? Because what they actually found out, it was magnesium sulfate. You dissolve this in hot water and maturate all the herbs inside there, and after that, take it up and dry it up. Usually, it will increase the weight up to 20 or 30%. And with the herb with light nature may increase up to 100%. And then, of course, labeling that that's not right and can be easily identified. And as to the some of the herb, we like to point out that studying in the past, all the herbs was imported from China without any examinations. But however, in studying 2012, the government imported a border control. They start with 10 most commonly used herbs. So before import into Taiwan, we need some certain institute to give some certificate says that it's qualified herb, then you will be allowed to be imported into Taiwan. But however, once it's imported into Taiwan, the government, we may do random check. And then if we were found it failed, then the next batch, they will do batch by batch for this particular importer until they pass in the next five import case. Then they will start to go back to spot check again. So this is currently we have 103 pharmaceutical company in Taiwan, and then traditionally, if because of the human use experience, so if you find a preparation or prescriptions recorded in some of the ancient herbals, you will be allowed to be produced, and of course they have a lot of quality control issues. And then they have to do TLC identification, and also for the 20 most commonly used preparations, they have the company was required to do two HPLC analysis on the 20 major TCM compound formulas, and also they set up some limit for the heavy metal, pesticide, etc., for those preparations. So finally, I'd like to conclude that the quality control of TCM herb is much more difficult than that of active pharmaceutical in the Western chemicals. And also, the quality of TCM herbal preparation only comes from TCM herb, which is good quality, and the authenticity of the TCM herb is the first point of concern for quality. So because of time limit, I have to stop here. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.